Hi, I'm Kubus van Rensburg. Join me now for Capturing Glory. We're going to go into the Word of God.
It's time for the church to come out of the closet and become visible. You are the city. You are set on a hill. You are the light of the world. Today, 2 Timothy chapter 1, put your hand to your Bible, say this is God's holy word, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Holy men of old spake as they were moved upon by the Holy Spirit. That anointing is in and upon Kubus to teach and speak, upon me to hear. This day right now is going to be a life-changing experience. In Jesus' name. Okay, I'll try and not run around the house. I'll try and sit here and be calm. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Verse 6 says, that's why I would remind you to stir up, to rekindle the embers of, to fan the flame of, to keep burning the gracious gift of God, the inner fire that is in you by means of the laying on of my hands. Verse 7. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, of cowardice, of craving and cringing and fawning fear, but He has given us a spirit of power and of love and of a calm and well-balanced mind and discipline and self-control. Do not blush or be ashamed then to testify to and for our Lord, nor for me a prisoner for His sake. But with me, take your share in the suffering to which the preaching of the gospel may expose you, and do it in the power of God. I think we all know that portion. But it springs out of the previous verses. Verse 5. Now remember, He just told him, I would remind you. Okay? So you can't be reminded if you haven't got a mind. So if you're absent-minded, I can't remind you. Okay? So I say, I have a mind. And I'm ready to be reminded. So if I'm reminded, it means I remember. Right. Verse 5. I am calling up memories. Hey. If I call up memories, I'm talking to your mind. So I'm reminding you to remember a memory. I am calling up memories of your sincere and unqualified faith. The leaning of your entire personality on God in Christ in absolute trust and confidence in His power, wisdom, confidence. Listen to this. A faith that first lived permanently in the heart of your grandmother Louise and your mother Eunice. And now, I am fully persuaded, dwells also in you. That is why I would remind you. Come on, if you don't get it, you'll get it later on today, but somehow you're going to get it. Faith. Look at the board. This faith was in grandma. This faith was in your mama. I am sure it is in you. Timothy wasn't sure. Paul was sure. Paul knew grandma, Paul knew mama. Paul says, I know the faith that your grandma had. I know that that faith was in your mama too. He says, now I am convinced. You better listen. He's so simple you can miss it. That's what T.L. Osborne told me 30 years ago when I stayed in his house for 2 days. He said, it's so simple you'll miss it. I walked out of his house. I took my notebook. I said, it's so simple I'll make it. And I made it a slogan in my life. It's so simple I can make it. He says, I am convinced that this faith is also in you. That is why I would remind you, stir it up. Now for years people say, oh, you've got to stir this gift, you've got to stir that gift, you've got to stir that gift. The context is, it's the gift of faith that you need to stir, that was in your mama and also in your grandma. You see, people want to stir certain gifts. Oh, if I can just stir that gift, I can stir that gift. Listen, God gifts, like we know and like we heard, it's by election, it's grace. God just give gifts. It doesn't repent him when he give gifts. But when it comes to this chapter in 2 Timothy chapter 1, I'm repeating it now, then we're going to go faster. Paul says, there was a faith that I knew your grandma had. There's a faith that I knew that was same faith was also in your mother. Now, I am convinced that this faith is in you. That's why I would remind you to stir up that gift that is in you, that inner fire that you got when I laid my hands on you, because I am convinced that you can have mama's faith and grandma's faith, because I saw some power there. That's why I want to tell you, God has not given you a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and of love, seeing it's a love conference, and of a sound mind. With that in mind, just turn to Hebrews chapter 13. Now, there was a revival in the 40s. They called it the healing revival because healing was the main topic. You know, and the first two guys that came to the front was two guys by the names of William Branham and Oral Roberts. They came the same time to the front, and the one was a very humble man. The one was a very bold man. William Branham used to get on the stage and he said, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. If I have said anything today that would have bring disgrace to his name, I would ask forgiveness. So if God sees fit to use us tonight by his great grace, it will be great to have him here today. Shall we bow our heads in prayer? Our Father, we come today. This is how he started. Oral Roberts used to be behind the curtains, and the curtains jumped up, and he came to the front, grabbed the mic, never used the Bible, never preached. He just had his sermons prepared, very good vocabulary and very good. He used to grab the mic and had it, you know, and they like, you know, more look more like a rock singer with a mic, you know. And he said, tonight I want to speak to you for 15 minutes about the topic, healing is for all. And then he would speak to two different guys, but the healing revival broke out. And in this healing revival, there were people like A.A. Allen, Jacko, William Freeman, names that many of you maybe know, many of names that you know. Great and awesome miracles happened. But the theme in most of the tents was, and they had it behind the tent, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And they had the people read it out. Read out loud with me tonight. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Man, and the miracles was just awesome. And A.A. Allen was so different, you know. He used to. They had these people on the stretchers, you know. And he used to come and, hello, boy. Mama, did you bring the man? You know. And he used to, you know, take the blankets of his son. You're going to walk today. And he reach out and touch the Lord. And he would say, you know, Jesus, 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 you're not going to fail us today, Jesus. And normally Jesus didn't fail them. Jacko was different. He was a short, fat Italian guy. He used to take the people, the wheelchairs, you know, and he would sit. You know, Simon Peter said, get up and walk. I'm going to approve on that today. You're going to jump up and run. And he would take the wheelchair and run to the edge of the stage, and he would tip the guy. Now, I don't know if the guy got healed because of faith or because of fear, but he got healed somewhere between there and there. I mean, there was this guy, Dr. Davis, you know, in the 46 revival. He was heading the Jacko team, you know, with Demas Hikarian that started the Full Gospel Business and Fellowship. And they brought this little boy in there one day, 4 years old. He had no bone structure, just flesh. Like you could wind him up like a piece of cloth, you know. No, everything was there. The fingers was there, the head, but no bones inside, you know. And they brought this little thing to the stand one day. And, you know, and they put him in Dr. Davis's hands. And Jacko was out. He wasn't there. And he looked, what am I going to do with this? And he said, Jesus! And he threw the child in the air and ran away. True story, true story. The power of God was so heavy in those healing revivals. The little boy came down, and when he touched the ground, he started running by the power of the Almighty God. Now, I want to tell stories, but that was the 46 revival. Everything was just miracles, miracles, miracles. And the main theme was Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, forever. Now go to Hebrews chapter 13. Now remember what we just read in 2 Timothy. Hebrews chapter 13. Verse 8. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. But what about verse 7? Remember your leaders and your superiors in authority, for it was they. Everybody says past tense. It was they who brought to you the word of God. Observe attentively and consider their manner of living, the outcome of their well-spent lives, and imitate their faith. I am sure, I know your grandma had faith. I know that same faith was in your mama. Now I am convinced that this faith is in you. That's why I want to remind you to stir up that faith. Because I laid hands on you, but now you must stir it up. Which faith? That Paul knew about the mama and the grandma. So Timothy didn't know. Now Paul comes and he says, remember those guys that were in authority and were spiritual leaders. Look at their well-spent life, the outcome of their life. Imitate their faith, because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. In other words, find out something about the faith of previous generations. Then try and find out what is it that made them operate in such power. And then try and imitate that faith. Elisha acted like Elijah and got double the anointing. What will happen if we start acting like Jesus Christ, like Paul, like Peter, like Smith Wigglesworth, like A.A. Allen, like Jacko, like Charles Spurgeon, like John Wesley? Oh man, what will happen if we start reading it and drink in and get something of their faith and add it to our faith and stir it up? What kind of people would we be? Okay, so we have examples of the Old Testament saints. Now people preach and say, the word faith is not mentioned in the Old Testament. You only find it twice. And that's where God says they had no faith. I'm sorry for all those preachers. Hebrews 11 is filled with people that had faith. Forgive me, I just thought I'll slaughter that cow. Chapter 11, verse 6. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Then he goes to Abram. Noah, Isaac, Jacob, Sarah. Is that right? Faith, faith, faith. Verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off. And they were persuaded of them and embraced them and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. All the people of faith in the Old Testament. Abram, the father of faith. Sarah, the wife of the father of faith. She's the mother of faith. Isaac and Jacob and David and Samson and Barak and Jephthah. You can call all these names. All these guys died in faith, confessing that they were pilgrims and strangers on this earth. In other words, they said, this world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. That's what they confessed. We are pilgrims and we are strangers. This world is not our home. Ephesians chapter 2. We're coming back to Hebrews 11 now. Verse 19. You are ready for word.
Yes.
Now therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but you are now fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. Jesus help. I know that there was a great faith in your grandma. I know this faith was in your mama. I'm persuaded that this faith is in you. That's why I remind you, stir it up, brother. Stir up this inner fire of faith in you. You must remember your leaders, those superiors that went before you. Look at these well-spent lives, and was they gone? Imitate their faith. See how they got it, and how you can, because I promise you, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So what they did, you can do, and then even more. So all these people that went before us died in faith, but they didn't get the promise. What promise? There's a promise that they didn't get. Why? Because their confession was, I'm a pilgrim and a stranger, I'm just passing through. I'm on my way to heaven, somewhere beyond the blue. I've got a cabin in the glory of glory land. Build my mansion next door to Jesus. Oh, I've got a mansion somewhere in heaven. And everything is geared towards heaven, and the world is going to hell at a pace, and we are just searching our own, seeing how we can get out of it. And we do not know that there's a people out there that need to be built together as a habitation of God in the Spirit. We are all supposed to do something. Now we are no longer strangers, but we are now part of the saints of the household of God. God is wanting a place that he can have a habitation in the Spirit, that people can say, God is in that place. God is amongst those people. Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Darkness will cover the earth and gross darkness the people, but the glory of the Lord shall be seen upon you. They will come from afar. They will carry their children. They will bring their riches, and they will say, behold, Zion, the city of God. And they will say, we can see that God is in you. You are the light of the world. You are a city that's set on a hill. You cannot be hidden. God wants a habitation for himself. If the whole earth is going to be filled with his glory, surely it must start with us. It's not just going to happen in Pick and Pay. It's going to happen with the saints. The world is saints, 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 saints. Back in Hebrews 11. Verse 16. But now they desire a better. Remember, they're strangers on this earth. So they desire a better. That is a heavenly. Listen. Wherefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. Look at my board. God prepared a city. For who? For the saints that died. You are with me. God prepared a city for those that died because they confessed that they are strangers and pilgrims on this earth. So God prepared for them a city. Verse 39, just picking up here and there. And these all having obtained a good report. Now remember 13, it's one book. Paul is building up to, you got to follow those leaders and imitate their faith because Jesus Christ, same yesterday, today, forever. These all having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. They didn't receive the promise. They didn't receive the promise. They didn't receive the promise. God, listen. Listen. God having provided something better for us. So whatever they got was not the promise. But whatever they got, God prepared for us something better. That they that are dead in faith, without us, should not be made perfect. God says all the saints that died in faith did not get the promise. But God provided something better for us that's alive. But they without us cannot be made perfect. Now remember chapter 6, you already said, let's go on to perfection. Remember, it's one book. So on the way to perfection, he's talking about them. Okay, verse 12. Therefore then, Since we are surrounded. I know you know it, but today it's going to hit you like an atomic bomb. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses that have borne testimony of the truth, let us strip off. Let us throw aside every encumbrance, unnecessary weight, that sin that so readily, cleftly, and easily cling to us and tangle us. Let us run with patient endurance and steady and active persistence the appointed course of the race that is set before us. Okay. So here are we. We are called saints on earth. Surrounding us are saints in heaven. Okay. The chair somewhere. Let me tell you my old story. The chair. Thank you, Hierarchy. This revelation I got, we were in the tent and I preached on heaven is on earth. And I was walking, I said, God, people are going to kill me. Everybody wants to go to heaven, and now I take the heaven away, I bring it to earth. I did. 1986, asked my wife, I preached the whole series, and I said, we've prayed for 2,000 years, let your kingdom come. Now they said, no, we're going to go. So there's a group going and a group praying, let it come. So somewhere when this group goes, this one is coming, and so, there's got to be confusion. If we say, where are you going? They say, back to earth. Where are you going? No, we're going up to heaven. So somewhere, something's wrong. We're praying, let it come, let it come. And the other group saying, now we're going to go. But this whole group prays, Father, send revival. Lord, pour it out. Any minute now, we're going to be going. Any minute now. But pray, oh God, pour out your spirit. God says, I'm confused. You want it, but you want to go. So I can't bring it, because if I bring it, you're going to be filled with glory. But you want the glory in heaven. You're going to walk there, and I want you to walk there. So, So God says, I can't pour it out because it, and God showed me this vision. A throne floating. And it's God's throne. And all of a sudden the throne came down. And he said, heaven is my throne. Isaiah 66. And earth is my footstool. I said, wow. He said, in the beginning God made heaven and earth. It's a unity. Heaven is not a planet you travel to. Otherwise, how can people see visions of heaven? They don't go to space travel. They stand just, I see. Yeah. I mean, there's John on the Isle of Patmos. He said, I, John, your brother, in tribulation and the kingdom. Okay, forget it. He was old. He says, I heard behind me a voice, and I turned around. Oh, what did he see? Heaven open. Where did he go to? Did he look up or did he turn around? Oh, sorry. I turned around to hear which voice was talking to me, and I saw one walking in the midst of the golden candlesticks. Where's John? He's so caught up in the glory. Oh, he is worshiping God. Here's the proof. Ezekiel says, I was sitting amongst the captives by the river Chebar, and the elders were sitting before me, and I had visions of heaven, and I saw the Spirit picking me up and putting me down in a valley full of dry bones. Can they live? He was sitting talking to the elders, and he was in heaven all the time. So John's turning around. He's now in that glory. He's seeing this. Oh, I see him. Oh, hair white as wool. A golden girdle. Feet like burning bronze. Eyes like flickering fires. The angels jumping up and down. Seven spirits, seven eyes. And then he looked around. And there's Jesus in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. In the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Candlesticks. But in front of the throne is seven fires, which is the seven spirits of God. There's the church. It's just a candlestick. The fire is there by the throne. The church is standing. There's no fire on the seven golden sticks. And Jesus is walking amongst the seven golden candlesticks. And John is now turning around. And Jesus, John, come up here. Come up here. Take the fire and get it on the candlesticks, or either get the candlesticks in the Holy of Holies. Okay, that's not the sermon. So, where's heaven? If you die and go to heaven, do you travel somewhere? No, you just turn around. I saw a cloud. What you're actually seeing is heaven is opening up. Okay. We are surrounded with a great cloud of witnesses. People that bore testimony of this great faith that they had. Verse 40 of chapter 11. God provided some better thing for us. They without us could not be made perfect. Verse 22. But you have come to Mount Zion. Even to the city of the living God. There was a faith in the grand guys. Then in the other generation. I'm sure you can have this faith too. So stir it up. So I want to remind you. So remember those leaders. Because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday to today. They all died in faith because they were looking for a city. I'm looking for a city. God says, because they were looking, they all died and they didn't get the promise. But they could never get the perfection without us because God planned something better for us. Hebrews chapter 12, we are now surrounded. Sorry if I did go over and over. We are now surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. So everybody that dies goes to the cloud, goes to the cloud, goes to the cloud. So we are surrounded with this great cloud of witnesses. Verse 22. You have come to Mount Zion. You're not going there. You have come to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to the city. You have come to the heavenly Jerusalem, to countless multitudes of angels. If you don't believe it, you don't have angels. And you have come to the church of the firstborn, listen to this, who are registered as citizens in heaven, and to God, who is the judge of all, and here it comes, to the spirits of the righteous heavenly people who have been made perfect. Explain it, and then we read the next verse. So we have come to the city. We're not going there. We have come to the heaven Jerusalem. We're not going there. We have come to innumerable company of angels, which is spirits that minister. We have come to the spirits of the saints that are made perfect. They could not be made perfect without us. Now us is here. Now they are perfect. But they are only perfect in spirit. But they are surrounding us in a spiritual realm, but in a perfect state of spirit. So their spirits are perfect. So they could not be made perfect without us. It does not say we are perfect. It says their spirits are now perfect. So they are surrounding us. So we must now imitate their faith, because something will happen and make our spirits perfect that we can operate in a power never seen on the face of the earth before. If that's not true, then the next one's not true either. Verse 24. And we have come to Jesus, the mediator of the New Testament. Did we? And to the sprinkling of blood, which speak of better and nobler things than the blood of Abel. Have we? So see to it that you do not reject him or refuse to listen and heed to him who is speaking to you now, because he says, you know, the voice on earth and now the voice in the heavens. So there are saints in heaven, which is a cloud surrounding us. They are called the church of the firstborn. They are perfect spirits, but they could not be perfect if the church wasn't there. So what is these perfect spirits? Why are they there? Why must we know that the Bible says they are surrounding us? Have they got a purpose, or is it just nice to go into a trance and say, I have seen Grandma Susie. You know what? She was sitting in a rocking chair and she said, my boy, everything is okay in heaven. You better bet everything is okay in heaven. God's on the throne. There's nothing wrong in heaven. No death, no sickness, no disease, no hospitals, no crime, no nothing. It's all perfect. So if they died in faith, and we must now imitate their faith to understand Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today forever. What does that mean? Because where does that bring us? Right? They looked for a city. They looked for a city. Abram looked for the city. Isaac looked for a city. Jacob looked for a city. They all died and they never get the promise. Because God prepared for them a city. Okay? God prepared for them a city. But they could not get the city. But God prepared something better for us. Now they can be perfect, but just not without us. So us has got to be somewhere to let the perfect spirits do something. Where did Jesus come to die? So where did he pour out his spirit? So where must the glory be revealed? What shall be filled with the glory? Oh, I just thought we must go to something together. So everything in this Bible is to bring it here, get it here, have it here. This is where God wants to move. God prepared something better for us. But he prepared for them a city. I'll read it. I wanted to quote it, but it's written good. Chapter 21, Revelation. Verse 2. And I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for a husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. Is there any scripture about there, or is it all about here? I'm so sorry. If you don't believe it, tear it out. Why leave it there if you don't believe it? Shocking people. Why leave it if you don't believe it? We can tear more out, and by the end of the day, you'll sit with a cover. Verse 9. And there came unto me one of the seven angels with that the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come here, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Verse 16, and the city lieth four square, the length and the breadth and the height and the depth the same. Ephesians 3. Just for those who don't know the stories. Are we the bride of Christ? Yes. You can go into my office. There's two thick dictionaries, a Webster's and an Oxford. This is what it says a bride is. A bride is a wedded wife. Yeah.
That's it.
Webster's and Oxford dictionary. A bride is a wedded wife. If a girl comes, he says, oh, look at the bride. She's not the bride. She's the bride to be. She's not a bride. She's a bride to be. Dictionary. Bride to be. After the wedding, you say, the bride looked beautiful. After the wedding. John, come up, man. Come out from this earthly realm into there. Come, I'll show you the bride, comma, the Lamb's wife. And he took me to a high mountain, and he showed me a city prepared as a bride for her husband. You are the light of the world. You are a city that is set on a hill, and the city had the glory of God, the mystery that's been hidden throughout ages and generations, so rich in glory, is now revealed. Christ in us, the hope of the glory. So Revelation, unfortunately, is not written chronologically, because John is caught up and back. And every now and then he starts the story all over again. And I saw the heavenly city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven, prepared as a bride for her husband. I saw it, and it's all past tense. All past tense. Ephesians 5:26. We are His bride. He has already sanctified us by the washing of the water of the Word. We're not going to be something. We need to realize we are something. And the minute we realize what we are, we come to a place where perfect spirits are, which by faith didn't get the promise, but by faith did some great stuff. And that faith will come to us, and we will have the promise of being the city filled with the glory, that people will start running to Isaiah 60 and say, we can see that you are Zion. You are the people filled with the glory. And then they will come with their riches. They will come with their children, and they will join yourself, and the whole earth will be filled with the glory. Just must we make something of this? There was a guy by the name of William Branham. And in the cities, God used him, but it was strange for people. And then in 1946, he came to the front with supernatural miracles. He used to call people out, and you know, and Branham used to say, I see you coming from a city surrounded by mountains. I see it's Pennsylvania. Your name is York, and your surname is this. And then we go on to say, I see you sitting sideways on a bed, and the doctor speaking to you. My sister, is all these things true? You can go home. You're healed right now. Miracles. Came to Bloemfontein in South Africa, 1951. Stadium was so full, they couldn't come in the right entrance, so they took a side entrance. And the people helped him in, Pastor Swanepoel and those from the AFM those days, they helped him in. And people were just jamming. And you know, they didn't know who Branham was. They didn't have TV and stuff. Just a small ad in the paper. American evangelist William Branham will be ministering in, you know, Olin Park in Bloemfontein. Okay, just listen. Here's Branham going through the crowds, trying to get to the pulpit. A little girl grabs him and says, excuse me, sir, excuse me, and looks down and hears this blind girl. Says, I lost my daddy, but he brought me here and said there will be a Reverend Branham that will pray for me and I will be healed. He said, my little sister dear, the Lord Jesus that knows you so well makes you well. There was such a stirring. The little girl started to see, and they took Branham to the pool at the right place at the right moment. I'll tell you one story. God knows why I tell the story. I want to get to that cloud and that city, man. But Branham was at this airport, and he's sitting, and it's boarding time. You know, suitcases, everything is checked in. And just as it announces they're boarding, God says to him, walk out of this airport. So he just gets up and walks out of the airport. God says, turn right. Turn left again. Turn right. He walks for a full half an hour. Comes into a black township. There's a big old mama standing on a gate. And she says, are you Parson Branham? He says, yes, ma'am. She said, God says you'll be here at 10 a.m. I got a boy here, 2 years in a coma. God says Reverend Branham will come pray for him 10 o'clock this morning. Walking, the little boy came out of the coma. Branham started walking back. He don't know where to go. Turn right, turn left. Come into the airport. As he walked in, it says, flight so-and-so that's been delayed now for 1 hour, 20 minutes is ready for boarding. I ask, would the flight be delayed if he was not obedient? Or did God delay the flight because somebody was obedient to the voice of the Holy Spirit? Now, that cloud is here, and that faith is speaking to us. In 1952, Branham returned to this country for a hunting trip in the Kruger National Park. But when he ministered, he came and ministered here in this city of Klerksdorp. Right? Now, in 1996, me and Annelies was ministering there with Franz and Netta in Durban. Ted, why was it so cold that night? My goodness. It's the only time in Durban we were so cold. And we had awesome meetings. Man, we had awesome meetings. That night we went to bed. They will remember the story. And I dreamt. I dreamt I was in this place, this big room. But it was like underneath a big building. You know where cars normally park and then it's the building on top. You know these big buildings. And you could see the exhaust fumes and stuff making, you know, marks against the walls. And they were all the piping and the plumbing and stuff. And I saw all these watches hanging there. Watches. And there's a wall that there was just one watch. I look, what's these watches, man? And God says, no, this is the times of people that left this earth. And they didn't know they had all that time to do stuff. But they were longing so much to go that they left and the time is still there. But nobody asks for the time. So I looked, but I was interested in that watch. So I walked over and this is how it happened. Sorry, I don't know why I tell this story now. But, I mean, there was this watch hanging. It was like this one. An awesome Tag Heuer, a decent one. Not the cheap one, expensive one. And it was hanging there, and it was full of root and stuff, you know. And I picked it off, and a nurse grabbed it. I said, what this nurse? She said, no, she's checking the times. This is where the people depart, and she wants to see if there's time left, you know. So she just hangs it up here. She said, but this one was hanging so long, they decided, you know, it's just going to hang here, so they didn't want to give it away. So she said, but I want it. And they wiped it off, and she gave it to me like this. And it said, William Branham. I said, what's this? God says, if you want, I'll allot all that time to you because he left and he's not here. So it's available. Okay, listen. How many weeks apart? That was there in Francis' house, 1996. I don't tell the whole story. About 2 weeks later, we're sitting in our church. Vessel and all of them were there. And we were sitting, it's after the meeting, and normally after the meeting, the glory is there. People stay behind and we sit on the steps. That's the old church. So we're sitting there just talking. Here comes two people in the church. That's way long after me. I said, there's the nurse. And then he said, what nurse? I said, it's the nurse with the watch. No joke. Here comes the woman with a Tag Heuer watch. She holds it out. She says, we're from Uppington. God says we must bring you this watch. We had to buy a decent watch. This is the most expensive one we could buy. So we just, and I looked and said, Tag Heuer. I said, can I tell you a story? Okay, I'm not going to tell you the whole story. But I want to say it. He came to Klerksdorp, this William Branham. And this photo was taken here in our city, in the manse of the AFM church. There's William Branham. Where was my finger? Middle. There's F.F. Bosworth, Ern Baxter, and Billy Paul Branham, the son, who's now old. But there's Branham. See those prophetic eyes, you know? And this was taken here, in this city, where we are today. So, in that year, a prophet came to our city, to the AFM church in Stilfontein. Frans was ministering the one night, and the other night, this guy was ministering. And this guy called me out. He said, stand up, Kubis. He said, God said, I came many times to the city of Klerksdorp. Oral Roberts preacher, T.L. Osborne preacher. All in 1952. I don't know 1952 because that's when I was born. I don't know why they did it that year, but it happened in that year, just for the interesting sake. And he said, but God says, I'm lifting all those anointings and I'm dropping it right here in Stilfontein over you. said, God, what are you talking about? He said, go tell the people. The cloud is all around us, and those anointings are available. Those, that faith that they operated in, but we got to realize they without us could not be made perfect. But we must realize we have come, we not going. If you're going, you're going to leave time behind. You're not going to fulfill what God has given you. You're not going to run your race and finish the course like we said last night. That was for the apostles of the Lamb that had to die. We must realize we are here to stay. We got to take over. We got to rule. We got to reign in life with one Christ Jesus. The city lieth four square. Okay? Are you here? In other words, the breadth, the length, the height are all the same. That means perfect. So if you do geometry, perfection is a cube. Ephesians chapter 3. For this cause I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. Oh, I wish we can just stand with everyone. To be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you, being rooted, Jesus, and grounded in love. What happens to an aircraft when it's grounded? It stays right there. Are you ready now? May be able to comprehend with all saints in heaven and on earth what is the breadth and length and depth and height. Full stop.
Come on.
Hey. He says, for this reason I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family and in heaven and earth is named, that he may grant you by the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might in the inner man, that you may come to know with all saints what is the length, the breadth, and the height. He says, I want you to know what is the length, breadth, height, and depth. I want you to know what is perfect. I want you to know what this city is. The next verse, and to know the love of God. And to know the love of God which passes knowledge. That you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Somebody help. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus, throughout all ages. Are you ready? World without end. So if you do not know that there's a world without end, you're still going and not getting the promise. The promise is the earth will be filled with his glory. The promise is there's the church that will be filled with his glory. The promise is that there is a city that came down prepared as a wife for a husband. The promise is that we will be the people that the world will say, behold, Zion, the city of God, and they will come to you with their riches. In other words, if we realize that everything that the Spurgeons had, the Wesleys had, the Branhams had, the Robertses had, the Jackos had, the Allens had, oh, the Whitfields had, the Cartwrights had, the Pauls had, the Peters had, all that stuff is coming to an accumulation. It is building up till somebody realized there's a cloud round and about us that wants to manifest with us. Ma, I've got a package here full of photos. This one is stored. I didn't know that was in there. See this photograph? Man, Jesus, why did this thing come out here today? There in the center is a piece of wood. Okay? This is T.L. Osborne's one of the greatest meetings he ever had. And they carried a dead man that was busy decaying. His flesh already came off his bones. And they threw him on the pulpit. And there's a piece of the pulpit there. All relics. I don't care what you call it. And this man was laid. A memento of our platform where the corpse sat up when the body was laid on the floor. You know what? They broke down an old church in Durban. An old church. They broke it down. In the church was this little photograph. Of some revival in the 40s. And when they took it, it fell and it broke. And behind the photo was this thing inside. Why did I get it? And the guy phoned and said, somebody said I must give it to Kobus van Rensburg. He loves stuff like this. How much photos? There's A.A. Allen in his tent. Jesus! I'm not going to fail this, Jesus. Oh, there's someone. I don't know what we can show you, man. There's T.L. Osborne. Now, this photo, this specific photo, was on my desk in my Bible school. And the lecturers came and said, remove that stuff. God is not doing this kind of stuff anymore. Maybe we don't have 100,000 here in Stilfontein. But brother, we went to Zimbabwe the first night they couldn't handle the crowds. We went to Mozambique. We went to Botswana. We went to Swaziland. I mean, the preachers are here in the house. I mean, the crowds is just too much. How many knows the story of Reinhard Bonnke? Okay. Oh, there's plenty. There's photos from the 1800s right through to now. There's Mr. Wesley. But in any case, there's hundreds. Just listen to me. I need to tell a story or two. Listen, this is going to bless you. Reinhard Bonnke studied in England. He couldn't speak a word English. They didn't want to accept him in the Bible school because he only spoke French. Oh, German, French. So,
sorry, this is why you put crutches up.
This is why I put crutches up. This is John Alexander's Dowie's Church, Zion City, Chicago. Now we've got our walls full of build-up shoes and crutches and quibbles. Why? Because of what I saw, the faith of the previous generations, and I realized the cloud is all around me.